Thank you. Could I ask those members who are leaving the chamber to please do so quickly and quietly as we move on to the final item of business, which is the members' business debate on motion 14344 in the name of Lorna Slater on 10 years since Scotland's independence referendum. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put, and I would ask those members who would wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons, and I call on Lorna Slater to open the debate. Around 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I woke up today feeling cheerful, even though today is not the anniversary of Scotland's Independence Day. I have very fond memories of the run-up to IndyRef 2014. Everywhere I went, work, the gym, people on the street, people were talking about first-past-the-post voting systems, the unelected House of Lords, the powers or lack thereof under devolution, and whether Scotland should be home to nuclear weapons. People were energised, interested in politics. This was the moment where we had the power to shape our future. I was not a campaigner for Indy. I wasn't involved in politics in any way at the time. I was working in Orkney on a wave energy machine. I travelled back to my home in Edinburgh to cast my vote for yes. And the next morning, when the announcement was made that the no vote had won, I had a terrible sinking feeling in my stomach. That feeling of an opportunity lost, a moment for a better future missed. Over the next 2 weeks, that feeling galvanised in me to the point where I sat at my computer and Googled Green Party and found the Scottish Greens and paid my £3 to join. The really interesting thing was that I wasn't the only person who did so. The membership of the Scottish Greens, I think, quadrupled in that week. Thousands of people joined up, inspired by the dream of a different future. The dream of an independent Scotland. The unionist parties in this chamber keep hoping that the question of independence will just go away. Instead, support for independence is strong. Before the referendum was called, I understand support was at about 27%. The campaign for Indy drove that support up to 45% on voting day, a huge achievement, in which Green Yes played a significant part. And still, it kept growing. Today, support sits at around 50%. We know young people overwhelmingly support an independent Scotland, so this looks continued to grow. The independence campaign inspired us because it gave us the chance to imagine something better, to engage with the big questions around how we build a society based on fairness, equality, and respect, how we redistribute wealth so that everyone has enough to live a dignified life, and how we play our role on the global stage to foster peace and good global citizenship. The Scottish Greens have long supported independence because of the opportunity independence gives us to build a fairer, greener, and more equal Scotland. There is a mystery here. Before 2014, when support for independence was much lower than it is today, the Westminster government deigned to grant us a referendum. But now, with support so much higher, with a pro-independence majority having been returned to Holyrood and Westminster time after time, they forbid it. Not only that, they refused to set out the conditions under which they would allow this democratic expression of the will of Scottish people to take place. Why are they so adamant? It's a great mystery. Could it be because they know they would lose? We were promised the most powerful devolved parliament in the world, but in reality, in the last 10 years, we've actually seen a rolling back of the powers of Holyrood, particularly following Brexit. We've had the Internal Markets Act imposed on us, which restricts our ability to make simple decisions, like introduce a national recycling scheme, or ban the sale of peat and compost. On top of that, We've seen the first indiscriminate use of Section 35 of the Scotland Act, Westminster using a veto over democratically agreed legislation passed by this Parliament. That is nothing short of an insult to devolution. The last 10 years have thrown up again and again the limits that Scotland faces as part of the UK, aggravated by a UK government so disrespectful of this Parliament and the entire concept of devolution. But we must not lose hope, nor should we lose sight of how our ongoing vision of what independence is for can be shaped and how the powers of independence can make people's lives better. This can start now with a reset of the devolved settlement here in Scotland. Both the Scottish and UK governments have said they support such a reset and are committed to working constructively together, but we've yet to see what that actually entails. Will there be a change in direction on the Internal Markets Act? Will the incoming government support the Sewell Convention instead of breaching it at every opportunity? At the very least, this must mean an agreement between this Parliament and the UK Labour government ahead of the next Holyrood election, setting out how and when a decision on independence can be made. What is the route to independence? What is the route to asking the Scottish people that democratic question? Because certainly...
Finlay Carson?
You seem to be focusing on the route to independence, but what about the route to the 65% of people in Dumfries and Galloway wanted to, this Parliament to concentrate and making sure Scotland benefited as being part of the Union?
Always through the Chair, Gordon Slater.
There was an interesting point made in the previous debate this afternoon where Douglas Ross seemed to say that democracy is something that you only do once. And then Ash Regan listed out a whole bunch of every single democratic event that has happened since 2014. And in fact, that's because democracy isn't something that you do once. Democracy involves going back and getting the consent of the people for the decisions that are made. That's why, Mr. Carson, we hold elections every 5 years and not just once. In Scotland, the Scottish Government and the Scottish Parliament must max out our powers to build a compassionate social safety net, to protect and... I hear some members chuntering along about a referendum. There's an interesting question here about whether these members would actually like to campaign for the Union, because I suspect they wouldn't. We can have a referendum...
Members, please...
Members can campaign for the Union.
Please sit down. Mr. Carson, I won't have this shouting across the chamber from a sedentary position. It is disrespectful to the person who has the floor, which person is Lorna Slater. Please continue.
Members should and enthusiastically campaign for the Union if that's what they believe in. But to not allow a referendum is a cowardly position. That is not a democratically justifiable position at all. The Scottish Greens will do everything we can do to ensure that by the time the 20th anniversary of 2014 comes around, we are celebrating it in a fairer, greener and independent Scottish Republic.
Thank you, Ms. Slater. And I now call Christine Graham to be followed by Edward Mountain. Speeches of up to 4 minutes, please. Ms. Graham.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. There's a famous play, Look Back in Anger, by George Osborne. And I look back not in anger at the result of the 2014 referendum, but with sadness at the lost opportunities for this talented nation. Up until the declaration at Dalkeith, I had no idea if we would win. Neither did the Tories and Labour at that count. When I saw we had lost, I put a brave face in it, but I felt sick to the pit of my stomach. The debates, the rallies leading up to that moment had been invigorating. Scotland was alive to the possibilities, or otherwise, of being an independent nation again. That 84% turnout was ballot-proof evidence of that engagement. Compare that to the 60% recently. Remember, Labour are in power on 34% of the UK vote on a 60% turnout. Hardly an endorsement of either Labour or the voting system. In 2014, much the same as now, the majority of the press were rooting for the Union. Gordon Brown, like a dark sorcerer, produced from his back pocket the vow. Greater powers if you vote no. Now we know where that went. Sorcerer that he was, it was smoke and mirrors. There were scare stories by Project Fear that pensioners would lose their pensions, the pound in your pocket would be worthless, and so on. That, together with being toughed out of the EU, did the trick. So here we are now, 10 years on. We voted 62% remain in the EU. Every single part of Scotland, every constituency, every council area did that, but we're out. Pensioners have one of the lowest pensions in Europe, and now their winter fuel payment is the first, though not the last, body blow to the most vulnerable. Heating costs are the highest in Scotland, yet we are fuel rich in green energy. We were told we needed the skills, the economic talents of the UK PLC and couldn't hack it alone. Our independent economy would sink us. So we had Boris Ovenready Johnson, all bluster and no substance, and a Brexit which has cost the UK economy dear. He took us out of the EU in the middle of a pandemic. How many regret they voted to be out? And never a penny was seen of that £350 million per week on the side of a bus. Then we were gifted Liz Truss, who with a stroke of a pen, a tap at the keyboard, plunged the markets into chaos, panicked the banks and set inflation into orbit. And pre-election, the First Minister and the OBR warned of an £18 billion black hole in the Treasury, upstep Labour and its £22 billion. What a surprise, pull the other one. In 2008, the banks collapsed. We in Scotland have only known austerity and Westminster economic incompetence. We were promised more of both by Sir Keir Starmer, and it's already begun. What could we have had? Top of the agenda, control of our own economy, the opportunity to invest in our natural assets, green energy, food and drink, research and development, tourism, and so on. We could have been like other small European nations, members of the EU in partnership. We could have been in partnership with our nearest neighbour, and indeed my place of birth, England, similarly as the Scandic countries are with each other. We could have had a decent pension for our elderly. Of course, independence would not automatically have brought a land of milk and honey, but it certainly would not be facing the grim landscape of a broken, bankrupt Britain. Now, I think the Scottish people have seen the fraud that was the Better Together campaign. Successive UK governments must fear a referendum, else why would they block it? Fool me once, shame on you. Fool me twice, shame on me. I know the Scottish people won't be fooled again. Look back, but not in anger, but to learn from the past.
Thank you, Ms Graham. I now call Edward Mountain, followed by Neil Bibby. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr Mountain.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'd love to say it was a pleasure to stand up to listen to a second debate on independence. It's not, because I learned as a soldier a long time ago that fighting the battle in the same way that it's been fought before will get you the same result. So I would say to Lorna Slater, you know, she said she wakes up every morning cheerfully. I do too. I wake up cheerfully because I'm alive and I'm a part of the union. And you wanted to know if I'll campaign for it? I'd campaign for it for every day. And for 12 years, I was happy to defend it where needed. Now, I would just say I would remind members of what Barack Obama said, is that if you seek to win a campaign by dividing people, you are not going to be able to govern them. Remember that, because this campaign was all about dividing people, setting families against each other and setting people across Scotland together. You can sit there and make as much noise as you like, because it was barely a year after the independence. Presiding Officer.
I'm sorry, I can't actually hear when two people are speaking at the same time exactly what each of them is saying. Please continue.
Okay. It was barely a year after the independence referendum that my son, having just returned from Afghanistan, was headbutted in Inverness by somebody who felt that he had no right to be there because his father was a supporter of the union. That's not joyous. That's not civic. And as far as going forward for an independence vote, if you really want to go forward for it, you've got to prove that you're competent in government. And this government hasn't got a record of competence in 17 years. We've got higher taxes. We've got a Scottish National Investment Bank that lost £14.6 million last year. And when they came into the committee and we questioned them, they didn't even know what their rate of return was on the £435 million that they had invested. Yes, I would take an intervention.
Kenneth Gibson.
On the basis of your logic, given the tens of billions that the incompetent Conservative UK government lost, should the UK still be independent?
Edward Mountain.
I'm not sure I follow your logic. The United Kingdom is a united front of people who stand together behind one flag and one government, and that's what I'm prepared to defend. Now, let's get back. We've got rising waiting lists in the NHS. We've got failure to meet cancer waiting times, including chemo and radiotherapy. I know about that. We've got a decline in our educational ability in maths and science. We've got an increasing attainment gap. We failed to reach our climate change targets. We haven't had the A9 dualled, as promised. We haven't had the A96 dualled. We've got ferries that are costing us £400 million instead of £100 million, and they're 7 years late. Yes, I would take an intervention.
Will the member recognise that he is describing the situation we are currently in the union?
Edward Mountain.
Yes, but these are all things, Ms Slater, which I'm sure you'll understand, are the responsibility of the Scottish Government, and the Scottish Government can control. Now, if you don't understand that, I'm surprised you were a minister. And we've also got, and let's be quite clear about this, when it comes to ferries, a ageing ferry fleet. Now, I would just say, and as I've made clear earlier, I'm very happy to stand up and defend the union every day. And I'm very happy to actually be able to raise a glass, albeit only water, this evening, to toast the Greens, because they have made defending the union easier by their incompetence in government, their failed DRS scheme, which is going to cost this country millions of pounds, and their failed action on rent control. So I would say to people, instead of sitting in here making lots of noise about why you think you should be independent, get on and prove your competence in government, which you've failed for 17 years to do. And frankly, I find that disgraceful. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
I now call Neil Bibby to be followed by Patrick Harvey. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr. Bibby.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I said in the last debate we should focus on the future, not the past, but that's somewhat challenging when the topic of this particular debate is specifically on what happened 10 years ago today. A decade ago today, the people of Scotland got to do something which few people in history have ever had the opportunity of, exercise their democratic right to determine their national identity and country's borders. In a world shaped by geography, conflict, colonialism and imperialism, it was a rare act of self-determination. When having a trip down memory lane, we can remember the remarkable democratic engagement the referendum sparked. But let's not forget, it was not a universally popular positive experience. It's wrong to suggest otherwise, and it's also wrong to not acknowledge the division it caused, not just in the country, but within families and between friends. Most importantly of all, let's remember that the people of Scotland spoke, and they did so decisively and affirmed Scotland's place in the United Kingdom. Many things, of course, have changed in what has been an eventful decade since. Brexit, the pandemic, Donald Trump, a land war in Europe. Prime ministers and first ministers have come and gone, some quieter than others. Some of the leading figures of the debate are sadly no longer with us, not least Alistair Darling. Other things remain the same. Scotland still to qualify for a knockout round of a major tournament. Summer remains an all too fleeting event rather than an actual season. The last 10 years should teach us all a lesson in humility, that none of us have a crystal ball and we can't predict with any certainty what will happen in the years ahead. Just as many on the no side could not have foreseen the Brexit debacle, neither could have the yes side predicted the repeated collapse in the... I'll take an intervention.
George Adam.
When the member says we don't have a crystal ball and we can't decide in the future, will he not accept that 10 years ago the people of Scotland were told that if you vote yes, you'll not be in Europe? If you vote yes, the economy will tank. All of these things have happened under the union. So surely we can get some honesty now from the unionists.
New baby.
First of all, 10 years ago, the SNP were willing to forsake our place in the European Union. They were warned that the European Union was going to... You were willing to foresee that. You called Juan Manuel Barroso, the EU president at the time, Commission president at the time, preposterous for suggesting that an independent Scotland would have to rejoin the EU. So actually, let's not be revisionist about this. It was the SNP that was willing to put at risk our place in the European Union. And I've just said we couldn't foresee Brexit. But equally, many of us on the no side couldn't foresee Brexit, but over the last 10 years, I presume none of the Yes campaign could have predicted the collapse in the oil price, events which would have brought an economic turmoil to a newly independent country. We should also have learned another lesson in the decades since the referendum, that beyond the binary of yes and no, there's a far richer debate about the devolution of powers, which is rooted in the realities of the modern world. For all the heat and light of 2014, both sides accepted this was a dynamic debate which accepted two unavoidable truths. This Parliament needed more powers and people wanted more decisions taken closer to home. But it also would be better if Scotland retained elements of the Union, whether it be the currency, the central bank, the monarchy, all propositions that were in the Scottish Government's white paper in 2014. As I said earlier, the constitutional argument exists on a spectrum, not a binary. That spectrum is not just about Holyrood and Westminster, it's about local councils too. Power close to home doesn't mean power should exclusively sit in Edinburgh. It means power handed down to our towns and our cities and our communities. Yet under the SNP, Scotland has become more and more centralised in recent years. Councils have been relegated to a role of delivery agents for the centre rather than a genuinely empowered level of government. The same is true of NHS services being centralised in Scotland and police services being centralised in Scotland. I believe this is the real debate now about Scotland's constitutional future. It is right for people to consider the best place for power to lie, whether that at Westminster, Holyrood, local authority or community level, as long as they are doing so in good faith, not blind faith. There is and always will be a place for this. But until then, Presiding Officer, we cannot continue to look backward. We cannot allow every discussion about Scotland's future to be reduced to a look back at the past. The people of Scotland deserve better than that. They deserve action, they deserve ambition, they deserve a government focused on improving their lives right now, not in some hypothetical independent future. So, Presiding Officer, let's not squander our time on debates that seek to divide us. It's time to move forward. Let's focus on the issues that matter to the people of Scotland. The path to a better future doesn't require breaking away from the UK. It requires vision, ambition and political will. And most importantly, it requires unity, not division.
Thank you, Mr. Bibby. I now call Patrick Harvey, who's joining us remotely, to be followed by Emma Roddick. Mr. Harvey, up to 4 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And I'd like to begin by raising my glass back to Edward Mountain. Thank him very much for reminding us all of the vandalism of Alistair Jack when he decided to put a wrecking ball through the deposit return scheme, wasting all of that investment, wasting the jobs that have been created. Just one example of his and the last government's contempt for this Parliament, whether on environmental policy, economic policy, equalities policy, or anything else. And I know that Mr. Mountain might wish that, as he described it, we were all united behind one flag. He's perfectly entitled to wish for that, even though it isn't true. But he's simply wrong in saying that we're all united behind one government. He has miscounted the number of governments within the UK. That's simply a matter of fact. Presiding Officer, I'm genuinely sad that I've not been able to be in Parliament today due to a personal appointment. It feels like I've missed a very special atmosphere all afternoon, to be honest, and I wish that I'd been there. And I know that some people have been discussing the atmosphere during 2014, during that referendum campaign. I've no doubt that there was some bad behaviour on both sides. I saw bad behaviour on both sides. But it was as nothing to the political violence that we've seen from British nationalism obsessions like Brexit, and as we've seen this year, from the British nationalist obsession with immigration as well. We should all condemn political violence, but it is simply absurd to suggest that the 2014 independence referendum was some low point in terms of our politics. In fact, I remember on referendum day, like so many politicians and campaigners, I spent some time outside a polling station speaking to voters coming in. And I spent that time sharing on social media examples of yes and no supporters showing empathy and interest and compassion and concern for each other. My favourite was from one of our campaigners in Edinburgh. He was on a polling station as well. And a guy came up to the polling station, people around yes and no campaigners standing together, having a chat, exchanging a biscuit or two. This guy, they thought he was probably into his 70s, maybe even older. And he came up to them all and said, "How do you do this, son? How do you vote?" He'd never voted before. And yet he was motivated in that moment to cast his vote, to exercise his democratic right to be heard. And campaigners on both sides were far more excited at the fact that he turned up to vote than they were in how he was going to vote. That did characterise, I think, a great deal of that democratic spirit of 2014. And that is certainly something we should celebrate. I think it is important, though, to acknowledge the pain that some of us do still feel. And for me, as I commented on social media earlier today, one of the most painful aspects of this is remembering having been dismissed, even laughed at and ridiculed for saying that if we voted no to independence, we would be endangering our place in Europe, that the UK was threatening to take us out of the European Union against our will. To stand there in a national televised debate, to express this concern and to be dismissed and treated with contempt, when in fact what we predicted is exactly what came to pass. Scotland voted to remain in the European Union and we were dragged out against our will. And the loss of freedom of movement, a freedom exercised by so many Brexiteers, and they've now taken that freedom away from young people. I do take heart, though, in the fact that young people in Scotland do not seem resigned to this being their fate. They do feel optimism and passion for a better Scotland. And I believe that in my lifetime, they will make it happen. If either government want to finally define what they mean by a reset in the relationship in the short term, OK, I'm open to that. I'm all ears to hear what ideas they've got for improving it. But it fundamentally must include an answer to the question that the unionists have left unanswered for years now. If at some point the people of Scotland do decide that independence is their preference, how may they make that decision? Those arguing for the union are entitled to do so, but they are not entitled to say that the people of Scotland cannot make that choice. And I believe they will.
Thank you, Mr. Harvey. I now call Emma Roddick to be followed by Douglas Lumsden. Up to 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. 10 years ago today, I missed a day of school to get some final work in for the Yes campaign. I started out my day at the Yankee Pier, holding a Yes sign, looking towards the horizon with an oil rig in the distance and a No voter behind me. And then I spent a lot of the rest of the day in Inverness getting out the vote before heading back over the Keswick Bridge to spend the evening in Dingwall at the Count as a member of Generation Yes. I went from genuine horror at the news that I was getting to vote early, because voting before you were 18 was early back then, to devoting every waking hour I had to the cause that I came to believe in. Christine talked about what could have been and what should have been, and I feel everything that she said, and I am sure that we took the wrong road 10 years ago. But that wasn't the last opportunity. We can still build a fairer, better and more exciting Scotland. Because I look at the United Kingdom and I still cannot imagine that if Scotland were already an independent country, the campaign to join the UK would gain very much traction. My party and others who believe in independence have a job of convincing others first. 10 years on, the biggest movement of the dial has been in response to Brexit. And what people saw happen there, what outraged them, that votes in other countries took Scotland out of the EU against our will when every single local authority here voted to remain, was very public. It got a lot of media attention, but it happens every day. In tiny ways and huge ways, from UK ministers taking years to sign a simple order on something that it's already agreed to devolve, to bringing in an Internal Market Act, which is used to limit the ambitions of this Parliament, what the Tories did to Scotland in 2016 is a regular occurrence. But I know that resenting injustice is not good enough on its own to win over hearts and minds. We also have to inspire. And I remember so much that was inspiring in that campaign in 2014, standing on street stalls, talking to people whose mouths fell open at the idea that Scotland's MPs very rarely impact on the makeup of the UK government. I took part in debates, and I remember that feeling of just being brand new to politics, but being asked to speak at an SNP meeting that 100 people had turned up to a school hall to take part in. I felt like my voice mattered. And I read a piece in The Guardian last night from other young people who were prominent in the Yes campaign, who were also given platforms and listened to, but who don't feel that today. And I hope that those people or people like them end up here. And I hope their voices are lifted up by my party and this parliament, because they have a lot to say and a lot to contribute. I believe that the SNP is going to be the party that delivers independence, but we will not convince others to back us if we are arguing for independence for the sake of it. They have to, like over a million people in 2014 were, be motivated by hope, a belief that making our own decisions and our own mistakes will make a positive difference to ordinary lives. We have to give those who were six at the time of the last referendum, the next generation, a reason to jump on a bus wearing a political badge and dare to imagine a better country. A reason to show up and vote every time, because their vote and who represents them does matter. It doesn't always matter right now, but I believe I'll see a Scotland when it does, if we prove as a party and as a parliament that we, Scotland, can do better with independence.
Thank you, Ms Roddick. I now call Douglas Lumsden to be followed by Mark Ruskell. Up to 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. While sitting in the chamber earlier today, listening to the Nationalists going over the same old arguments about independence, I decided to look at the agreement between both our governments that set out the referendum in 2014 to take place. It said, the governments are agreed that the referendum should have a clear legal base, be legislated for by the Scottish Parliament, be conducted so as to command the confidence of parliaments, governments and people, and deliver a fair test and a decisive expression of the views of people in Scotland, and a result that everyone will respect. And that is the problem, Presiding Officer. The Nationalists have never respected the result of the referendum and have embarked on a journey of grievance politics to make their case for another referendum. We shouldn't really be surprised. After all, it's all the SNP exists for, to try and rip our country apart. Not to improve the lives of Scots, not to run our country well and bring economic growth, but to sow division and use every tool in their Nationalist toolbox to cause that division, even using the doomed DRS scheme as a weapon. And their Scottish Green chums are no better. They must be the only Green party in the world who care more about division and gender ideology than climate issues. Presiding Officer, I do... Not at the moment. Presiding Officer, I do like one part of the motion today, and that is, understands that support for Scottish independence has consistently polled at 45% to 50% of Scotland's population in the decades since. So that tells me that support to remain part of the United Kingdom has consistently polled at 50% to 55%, which shows that despite a pandemic, a war in Ukraine, three new First Ministers, six Prime Ministers, Brexit, four general elections, one of which was meant to be a de facto referendum, Jamie Hepburn as Independence Minister, the constant stream of independence papers that even Hamza Youssef admitted that nobody reads, the desire for independence hasn't increased one little bit. So it's time for this Parliament to focus on what it was created to do, to improve the lives of Scots using the power it has, and put aside the constitutional grievance that is holding Scotland back.
Mr. Adam,
thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr. Lumsden. And I now call Mark Ruskell. Up to 4 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And can I thank Lorna Slater for giving us the opportunity to have some fun with the buttons in the chamber, but also to reflect on those momentous times 10 years ago. I was a Yes activist in Stirling, and I was a local Green councillor at the time as well. And I'll never forget the sight of seeing 16-year-olds in their school uniform turning up class by class to vote in that referendum. It was an incredible time of political empowerment. And I think, you know, Emma Roddick's speech just there, reflecting that This is perhaps one of the first times when she felt that her voice mattered politically. Oh, your voices did matter so much. And it's a delight to see so many of those Yes activists now taking seats in our local government, but also in this parliament as well. And I hope many more will take these seats in the years to come. I remember some great days, actually, knocking on doors in the Raplock in Stirling. It was barbecue weather, and folks were out on their front yards, friends, family, neighbours, and they were having a really good debate, a really good natter about all of the issues that were relevant to this referendum, from pensions to Trident. And, you know, this is in a community that historically had had an incredibly low electoral turnout at every single election. So to see that empowerment and to be part of that conversation was fantastic. I learned when to shut up sometimes as well. But it was wonderful. And I think, you know, if you contrast that with what we then saw a couple of years after that with the European Union referendum to decide our future within the European Union, which was tarnished by the lies of the Leave campaign, which was built on ignorance. And if I have one personal regret in politics, it's the fact that I probably didn't spend anything like as much time as I would have liked to have knocking on doors, talking to people about the benefits of the European Union and about our role within that European family of nations. Because of the timing, because it was so close after the Holyrood elections, I didn't spend that time. And I really regret that, because I wanted, I suppose, now to be able to take that spirit of that referendum into that question about whether we should remain within the European Union or not. But what's absolutely clear is that Brexit has been an utter disaster. We live in a world that is more interdependent than ever. We live in a world where states need to show solidarity with each other, whether it's about tackling the climate crisis, delivering our global security, or our shared prosperity. But it is not incompatible with independence. And in fact, membership of the European Union requires independence. It requires sovereign states to join, to work together, and to flourish. And if you have any doubt about that, go to Dublin, go to Ireland, see a flourishing nation, an independent nation within the European Union, which is doing just that. So when I see poll results come out this week that shows that 56% of Scots want to see an independent Scotland within the European Union, that fills my heart with hope for the future. When I went in to vote, presiding officer, back in 2014 to vote yes for an independent Scotland, I took my 8-year-old son with me, and I had a huge amount of pride in voting for yes, and a huge amount of hope for his future as well. But my hope now is that now he's grown up, now he is a man, I hope that he will have the opportunity to make his own choice for the future of this country. And I hope, along with the majority of Scots, I hope that he will vote for an independent Scotland in the European Union.
Thank you, Mr. Ruscoe. And I now call on Cabinet Secretary Angus Robertson to respond to the debate. Around 7 minutes, please, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And may I begin by thanking Lorna Slater for securing this debate and paying tribute to contributions by Christine Graham, Edward Mountain, Neil Bibby, Patrick Harvey, Emma Roddick, Douglas Lumsden, and Mark Ruscoe. One particular reflection from the debate that we're now holding and the one earlier today, which I don't think has actually been teased out and reflected on very much, but I do think is important to have an airing in this place, is something that I hope there is agreement on across the chamber, between parliamentarians and between parties, that democracy is not a moment in time. Democracy is not a single vote. Democracy is not a single question. Democracy is how we govern our society, and it's something that we trust the public to be able to use, regardless of the party they vote for or how they determine a question. That may be a constitutional question, of course. That's why we regularly get to choose who represents us, at what level, at local government, at Scotland's national level, at a UK level, previously at a European level. And it also means that we have, in this country, been able to discuss and debate and decide on more than once the constitution of the UK in relation to Scottish self-government, with a devolution referendum held not once, but twice, Once in, if I can finish this thought and then I will defer, of course. In devolution in 1979 and then in 1997. And it's something that we were able to determine in Europe in 1975. I was still at primary school, and this is actually a germane point about generations changing and new voters coming into society and them also being able to have a say on big questions. And there was a second European referendum, as we know, to our great cost in Scotland in 2016. And the point that I would genuinely wish to impress on colleagues who have not embraced the point that I'm trying to make here is that I would genuinely hope that all Democrats here agree that we should be able to decide and reconsider when we as a society, whenever, see fit. And whilst I appreciate that for supporters of the union, and I'll give way to one of them in a second on this very point, I appreciate that while supporters of the union don't want independence, they wish to remain part of the United Kingdom, it's very important to them. I recognise that. I respect it. But there has to be, in a multinational United Kingdom, a democratic route to a democratic vote. Not a one-off. If we, however we determine that we should be able to have another vote, we should be able to do that. And I would encourage everybody to consider how we can allow democracy to flourish when, in actual fact, a democratic vote is being denied. If there is a change of circumstances, especially if there's a change of circumstances, we should be able to take a view on that, and Brexit was most certainly a change of circumstances. I give way to the Conservative member.
Ed, thank you very much. I appreciate you giving way. And like Mark Ruskell, I spent many days and hours knocking on doors with that civic pride about door after door in Dumfries and Galloway. People were saying they wanted to remain part of the United Kingdom. And the Unionist campaign drove people to vote as well. It wasn't just the Yes campaign. But on the question of when do we have another independence referendum, the problem was we had a vote, and we're not going to argue about whether it was generational vote or once in a lifetime. The issue was there was a clear message that the people of Scotland at that time wanted to remain part of the union. But the very morning after the vote, the Scottish Government started their campaign for another independence referendum. And that's what doesn't sit comfortably with people right across the country.
Cabinet Secretary.
I've already acknowledged that if I were a supporter of the union, I'd rather not have to debate all of this again, and I'd rather not have another vote. But my question has still not been answered about what mechanism do those who oppose independence agree, as Democrats, should be able to trigger an important vote. We already have that in the United Kingdom, incidentally. A mechanism already exists in a part of the United Kingdom. It's called Northern Ireland. And as part of the Good Friday Agreement, there is the ability to hold a border poll, and that should be able to happen every 7 years. So there's a mechanism for Northern Ireland, there's no mechanism for Scotland, for Wales. There is, of course, for England, because only a majority of parliamentarians in England need to vote in favour of it, and then it would happen if people in England wished a referendum. I'm sure I'm going to run into difficulty with time, so I'm going to try and make some progress. Happy to speak to colleagues after the debate, of course. Now, as was noted in the motion, the referendum was an important democratic event. Wherever we sit in the chamber, we can all agree that we witnessed democracy in action. It was overwhelmingly positive. I'm looking at Edward Mountain here because I know about his family case. And it grieves me. And I'm sure it will make some people uncomfortable on the other side of this argument, rereading quotes from a former member of the Westminster Parliament who talked about bayoneting the opponents of independence. I'm sure he meant metaphorically, but that kind of language did not contribute to a universally positive experience in relation to the referendum. Having said that, I do agree, and the history books will bear me out, I have no doubt, that it was an amazingly inclusive event. It energised generations of people and a belief that a different future was possible. And I would hope that maybe it energised some supporters of the union to making sure that the union might actually improve. Although I do observe that I literally have read not a single column by a single commentator who opposed Scottish independence actually drawing attention to the amazing progress that we've been able to see since 2014 on the basis of all of the promises were made by the no side. The debate was, of course, lively. It was, for many, for most, about hope, about optimism, and for months and years preceding the vote, encouraged discussion and debate as vibrant and diverse as Scotland itself. Now, this year we also marked the 25th anniversary of devolution in this Parliament, of self-government. Scotland voted overwhelmingly, 74%, to reconvene the Scottish Parliament to address a democratic deficit. And this followed decades of Westminster governments imposing unwelcome and damaging policies of Scotland. The positive impact of devolution is indisputable. Decisions made in this chamber have made Scotland a better, a fairer place. For example, free university tuition, minimum unit pricing for alcohol, a ban on smoking in public places, equal marriage, land reform, personal care for older people, 1,140 hours of funded early learning and childcare, and the child payment. Of course, people will always be able to point to, why not more of this? Why not less of that? That is the stuff of politics. That's why we're here. And we have to raise the boats, of course we do, to do as well as we can. None of that is an argument against being able to make decisions closer to home. And the benefits of 25 years of devolution that were delivered due to the strength of this Parliament and members right across it in different parties, even those that opposed devolution in the first place. Now, we can agree that decisions about Scotland's future are best determined by people living here, surely. And devolution has evolved since 1999 with substantial changes to the powers of the Parliament in the Scotland Act 2012 and Scotland Act 2016. And since 2014, the Parliament has used these powers to set taxes on income, reform the tax on house sales, creation of the Scottish National Investment Bank. And we've worked hard across this chamber to respond to the best interests of Scotland and major challenges, including the COVID-19 pandemic and Brexit. Devolution can only function if UK governments respect the decisions reached by the devolved legislature and the very safeguards created to protect them, such as the Sewell Convention. I very much hope the UK government is seized of this and we are able to ensure that devolution works as it was supposed to without it being undermined. Looking back to 2014, the turnout was the highest recorded at any Scotland-wide poll since the advent of universal suffrage. Grassroots campaigns for both sides emerged to discuss the challenges and opportunities. And from 2007, this government encouraged a national conversation, providing people with the information needed to make an informed decision on behalf of themselves, their families, their communities. This work has continued through a Building a New Scotland prospectus series, which has updated the case for independence in light of Brexit. And my concern is that the people have given this government a clear mandate for a referendum on independence. There is a majority in this chamber for there to be one. And if that is not the best mechanism, I do not know what is. I'm still waiting from others to hear what
the Cabinet Secretary is bringing his remarks to close.
What mechanism there should be to be able to hold a referendum, a clear and legal route. The people should have the opportunity to determine their constitutional future again. This government has always sought a principled and a pragmatic approach to engagement with the UK government. There is a substantial opportunity to achieve better outcomes for the people of Scotland when we work together. We want to build relationships based on trust and understanding. That must include respect by the UK government for the Scottish Parliament devolution settlement. And since 2014, there has been much change and Scotland has faced its challenges, but there is much to be proud of, as I have highlighted. And when it comes to Scotland's future, there is much more work to be done if we are to create the modern, the diverse, the dynamic Scotland we all want to see. And as the First Minister made clear in this afternoon's debate, we could make a greater impact with all the levers of powers of an independent nation. And as we have seen since 2014, decisions about Scotland's future are best determined by people who live here in Scotland. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting.